Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Philip. That was when I was young. And today I would like to... I have prepared like some overview of the literature, and a little bit I suggest my experience with the epidemiology of knee ligament injury. In the modern world, we live in a society obsessed by sports. At recreational level, this allows an escape from the pressure of daily life. In the elite level, sport has become part of media industry with enormous material income for the participants. For all of them, injury is a permanent threat. Of all these injury of the knee are most often most difficult because of permanent disability and long stay out of the sport. I have done a little bit overview of last 15 years what was published in the literature. I'm going to start, as you see, by England. There is a paper published in 91 by Sheffield, that they call Sheffield study. The knee was the most commonly injured joint in soccer, in rugby. And for that reason, they say for these two national England sport, rugby and football, that is not so much a matter of the sport as a matter of knee diseases. Interesting study coming from Switzerland, where Majewski had done an epidemiological study, had documented 9,500 injury over a period of 10 years. 40% of these injury was related to the knee, and most often the people was between 20 and 29 years old, that means young people. 2,763 of them undergo arthroscopy, and ACL tear was constructed in 50%. Sports, that soccer and skiing, have most of injury. Other side of the world, there is interesting study from Love, who had done review of 19 study about epidemiology of knee injury among adolescents. And he find that the knee injury prevalence range between 10 and 25%, and in a recent study they report higher percentage. Lots of study about young people have been done in the United States because they have so much high school and college athletes. And the study of Ingram, they studied, that was epidemiological study in 100 high school boys and girls in period 2005-2006 and 2006-2007, and they find that knee injury rate was 3.89 per 10,000 athletic exposure. Three times that was higher in the competition, and 67% of major knee injury was happening in competition. When we compared boys and the girls, the knee injury rate was higher in the boys, but girls for their knee injury sustained two times more surgery. And the sports of risk was football and wrestling in boys and soccer and basketball in girls. Very interesting study come from Qatar, from Cristiano, and people from sports medicine. They had followed Qatar national team for 70 Qatar national team in football for 70 months, documented all injury that happened in the training and the competition, and they find that me was second most injured side in the body after the tie, and most of these injury happened in competition. And finally, the study who is coming from France, Pierre Chambard, that lots of you know him personally, was the doctor of skiing national team for a period of last 25 years. And he find that in these top athletes, 28% female and 27% male skiers sustain at least one ACL injury. Rate of re-injury on the same knee was 90% and the other knee was 70%. I don't have a time to continue analyze different study, but in past 15 years, when I done review of the literature, what conclusion I can take from it, that the methodology of this study is often not well done, and it is very difficult to analyze because they utilize different methodology, different definition of injury, validity and reliability of measurement tool were most commonly shortcomings of this study. We have impression that methodology quality of the recent study have improved. For that reason, I'm going to spend a few minutes to remind you about that epidemiology is basic science of preventive medicine, that epidemiology is the study of distribution and determinants of varying rates of injury or other healthy states in human population. Doing an epidemiological study is a lot like being a detective, using logic to discover cause and effect relationship of injury in population. Why we utilize in sports medicine the epidemiology? To identify the cause of injury, provide a more accurate picture of the clinical reality, and to determine the effectiveness of preventive measure. The rates most often utilized in epidemiology are prevalence and incidence rate. That's only the case we developed in the study. Why I choose now to focus myself on the review of epidemiology only of ACL injury in the literature? In the light of four epidemiological questions: incidence rate, risk factor, gender, mechanism of injury, outcome of treatment, and effectiveness of preventive measure. Because there are a number of different studies of the knee in the sport, but most published studies are in English. And in first study in reality about knee surgery on the ligament started in early 70s. And now we have about 9,000 scientific papers. And Googling today, ACL gives you 1.1 million hits. Second, ACL is the most disrupted knee ligament. And the annual population incidence in Sweden is 81 per 100,000 inhabitants. Today, they do 200,000 ACL reconstruction per year in the United States with direct cost of $3 billion. I'm going to try to answer my question. Incidence, risk factor of injury, extrinsic and intrinsic. Extrinsic are related to the sport, to equipment, to shoes, to better condition, and so on. And there was lots of publication about it. When we are talking about intrinsic factor, there was also lots of publication about it, and I'm going to, because I don't have time, tell you that now we have studied about genetic personal factor, and we are talking about TT genotype, the coil 1A, 1SB, 1, and there is study from South Africa. In the recent years, there has been a great deal of interest in ACL injury in women athletes. Multiple studies have been published that women involved in the similar sport as a men counterpart have increased the risk of ACL injury. The incidence rate of this injury in women was 2 to 7 times higher than in their female counterpart. Why female athletes are more susceptible to an ACL injury than the male athletes performing the same activities? 4 theories was proposed to explain it: hormonal, biomechanical, anatomical, neuromuscular, and movement pattern difference. But I have to tell you that these findings are non-conclusive in the literature. Let's see first few words about hormonal theory, that fluctuation in sex hormone during menstrual cycle have been suggested as possible risk factor for ACL injury. Some studies have identified increased risk during each phase of menstrual cycle, but paper published in the literature didn't show the results conclusive. Also, we can say that oral contraceptive drugs don't protect from injury. There was also some anatomic consideration that women tend to have a smaller notch than the men. Theoretically, at least, a narrow notch can do the impingement and to do the damage of the ACL. That women have wider Q angle that produce with the genu valgus produce bigger stress on the knee. But all this study, however, are not conclusive. And finally, they analyze movement pattern in the ladies, and they find that landing movement, ladies are doing with more internal rotation of the femur, and that they are landing with more with knee more in extension. That can that are a risk for AC injury. As I told you, there was lots of study, 9,000 in recent year about ACL, but we are still discussing about mechanism of non-contact injury of the ACL. 2 theory are sagittal plane hypothesis and valgus plane hypothesis. Sagittal plane proponents argue that ACL injury results from loading in sagittal plane primarily as a result of anterior shear caused by forceful quadriceps contraction when landing or cutting. Other people talk about valgus collapse mechanism And there is a study of Quartland and Hewitt, and they show that female athletes land with the knee more in abduction, and that is predisposing knee for injury. They also seem give importance for trunk motion. But in conclusion, what we can say that ACL injury occurs during complex, multiplanar loading mechanism during multiplanar sport movement rather than during single plane mechanism of injury. Finally, I would like to remind you of the study of Dr. Shamba, who had operated 30 elites alternate care, and he find that in this particular group of sportsmen, they had 50% at least one ACL injury. And 50% of them who was operated had multiple knee injury. And I would like to remind you that today most of the proposed solution is ACL reconstruction, but I would like also to remind you that ACL reconstruction have to be for all the life, that should be a golden standard, not the stability for short period or sport career. Lots of debate was about hamstrings, patellar graft, and I'm going to leave that discussion for my colleagues, but I would like to, from epidemiologic viewpoint, to remind you that at 10 years from 100 patients who have undergone ACL reconstruction, doesn't matter hamstrings or patellar graft, and continue to do sports activity, at 10 years will suffer another ACL injury, which they have patellar or hamstring graft. What is the difference? The difference lies in the distribution of injury. With patellar graft, at 10 years, they have lower incidence of injury operated knee, but much higher incidence of injury of contralateral knee. In hamstrings, at 10 years, they have higher rate of injury of operated knee, but lower of contralateral knee. Surgeons who are doing patellar graft, they are going to tell you that their graft had resisted better than contralateral normal ACL. But for the sportsman, it's the same things. New operation is needed. Finally, question concerning osteoarthritis, arthritis, from epidemiologic viewpoint. Lots of people think that ACL reconstruction is going to prevent osteoarthritis. But in the literature, there is lack of evidence to support a protective role of ACL reconstruction surgery against development of osteoarthritis, because in 50% of people at 10 to 20 years we are going to have painful knee with sign of osteoarthritis. Why? Because at the moment of injury there is a lesion, and now that's going to develop. That dramatic increase in the risk of further osteoarthritis, which remains burden to the patient, a challenge for a clinician and key for the involved for the people involved in prevention, take us to prevention of AC injury. Can we do something to prevent some of these injuries? Many researchers feel that well-structured training program that implies neuromuscular and proprioceptive training offer encouraging evidence of the prevention of non-contact ACL injury, especially in female football players. And there is a study, who is talking about the importance of neuromuscular training. There is study of Soligard who is talking about importance of warm-up program. And finally, there is a study of Gilchrist who is talking about prevention of contact injury with the well-done proprioceptive program. Can we say the problem is resolved? No, because today we still don't know why so much about this mechanism of non-injury. Why some sportsmen landing, cutting all the time in the same position don't have ACL injury and other have it? That once when we do understand better this mechanism of non-injury, we are going to be capable to develop the program of prevention of these injury, who are going to be less consuming time for the athletes, more acceptable for the coaches, and especially we could introduce them to the person with the risk. And I would like to finish that intelligent can solve will prevent their occurrence. And finally, for our guests from United States and Australia, after being in Qatar, I think that you are going to support Qatar for Football World Championship 2022. Thank you.